Good morning. Welcome to First Presbyterian on Memorial Day weekend. I am Carissa, and later Keith will be sharing with us the story of Jesus and Nicodemus. If you are watching online later today, we thank you for taking the time to engage in our worship. Please take the time to fill out the connection card and drop it in the offering box as you leave today. Your gifts and offerings make it possible to share God's word and love with those in our church and in our community. We will have Vacation Bible School here on June 24th through the 28th. From 2 to 4 p.m., and the theme is scuba. Help us spread the word and sign your kids up for a great program. You can talk to Cassandra for more information, and she does have a flyer with a QR code that will link you straight to registration. We also will be starting our Summer at the Movies series next Sunday, June 2nd. We do have a flyer for that as well, in case you'd like to pick one up for reference or maybe to give to a friend or neighbor or coworker and invite them to come with you. We'd love to see many new faces this summer. This will be a fun series that will start with watching a different movie trailer each Sunday, and it will come with a message that connects to Scripture. So we probably don't look for that in movies as we watch them, but take our word for it. You'll be able to sit back, relax, and hear a different perspective on how popular films can point us towards the gospel. This Memorial Day, we remember those heroes who courageously gave their lives. May we never forget that freedom isn't free and comes at a huge price. Thank you to the brave men and women who have made that ultimate sacrifice for our freedom. We honor them today. May the examples of their sacrifice inspire us in the selfless love of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ. If you are a veteran, or maybe have lost somebody to the service, would you stand today so we can recognize you in the sacrifice? Thank you very much. It is time for our worship to begin. It is our hope and prayer that you will be blessed as we praise God together this morning.
Good morning again. I'm sure you heard my voice anyway, so it doesn't really matter, but it's great to have you here. You know, we had a great night on Thursday night at Messy Church. It's our final one for the summer. We had up to about 40 families and people here, and the kids were getting wet, and there was such joy. And we're just thinking, you know, I hope we can bring joy every week when we come to worship, and hopefully we can shine a light. And this first song is called My Lighthouse.
In my wrestling and in my doubts, in my failures, you won't walk out. Your great love will trouble sea. Whoa. You are the peace in my trouble sea.
You are the peace in my trouble.
This next song is called Great Things. And today when we're talking about Nicodemus, and Jesus, I think Nicodemus found it really hard to get his head around what Jesus had done and came for. And couldn't really grasp the great things that Jesus did for us. So as we worship this and sing this, let's try and remember all the great things that happen in our lives, the good things that God gives us, and not take them for granted. This is Great Things. Let's just pray before Caitlin comes and reads to us today. Lord, we just thank you. We thank you that you've done great things in our lives and the lives of millions and billions of people across the world. Lord, we ask that we will remember those that have sacrificed so that we can be free. Lord, we lift their families and we ask you to give them peace and a blessing for all those that are serving today, here at home and across the world. We pray for their protection. We pray that they'll know your presence. And today we say thank you. We ask it all in Jesus' name. Amen.
Good morning, everyone. Today we are reading from John chapter 3, verses 1 through 17. Now there was a Pharisee, a man named Nicodemus, who was a member of the Jewish ruling council. He came to Jesus at night and said, "Rabbi, we know that you are a teacher who has come from God, for no one could perform the signs you are doing if God were not with him." Jesus replied, "Very truly, I tell you, no one can see the kingdom of God unless they are born again." "How can someone be born when they are old?" Nicodemus asked. "Surely they cannot enter a second time into their mother's womb to be born." Jesus answered, "Very truly, I tell you, no one can enter the kingdom of God unless they are born of water and the Spirit. Flesh gives birth to flesh, but the Spirit gives birth to spirit. You should not be surprised at my saying, 'You must be born again.' The wind blows wherever it pleases. You hear its sound, but you cannot tell where it comes from or where it is going. So it is with everyone born of the Spirit." "How can this be?" Nicodemus asked. "You are Israel's teacher," said Jesus, "and do you not understand these things? Very truly, I tell you, we speak of what we know and we testify to what we've seen. But still, you people do not accept our testimony. I have spoken to you of earthly things, and you do not believe. How then will you believe if I speak of heavenly things? No one has ever gone into heaven except the one who came from heaven, the Son of Man. Just as Moses lifted up the snake in the wilderness, so the Son of Man must be lifted up, that everyone who believes may have eternal life in him. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, and whosoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but to save the world through him."
I had 613 rules to follow. Can you imagine that? Can you even understand how many that is? And I knew every one of them, and I followed them, mostly. So there I am, sitting across from Jesus. And he looks at me and says, "Nicodemus, it's not about the rules." I'm paraphrasing him, but essentially that's what he's saying. It's not about the rules. Not about the rules. Look at this from my perspective. I'd seen him come in the day before, and he had turned the temple upside down. This is the place, mind you, that I'd spent my life preserving. So you can imagine how much I wanted to have a talk with him in a secluded place at nighttime. How would you feel if someone said to you, someone you respected, they tell you that everything that you'd dedicated your life to had missed the mark completely. You're a fool. That's how you feel. So I said something to him. One rule that seems too good to be true, because it was. Believe he's the Messiah. Believe he's the one that was promised. And he said it, like he just glazed over it, like it was some simple thing. And then went on talking about good and evil. And I'm thinking, wait, go back to where you took what was so complicated and made it not complicated. My whole life was in those complications. My religion was in those complications. Making sure to follow the details of the laws. I made sure that every T was crossed. I thought that is what was going to save me. 613 laws. I was wrong. It was love that saved me. For God so loved.
Let's just bow our heads. Lord, we thank you that it is your love that saves us. Your love for each one of us, no matter who we are. Lord, help us to break free from the rules and the things that we think we should be doing and concentrate on who you are and how much you love us. Bless us today. Open our hearts and minds. Speak to us. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. I know that was a longer video than we normally watch, but when you hear maybe some of the thoughts that maybe would have been going through Nicodemus's mind, and to hear about all the laws that he had to follow when he wasn't even Presbyterian is, you know, quite remarkable. But so often we get caught up in the do's and the don'ts, you know, and you should do this and you shouldn't do that. And basically in this story, we're finding that it's not about the do's and the don'ts, it's about discovering who Jesus is and who Jesus sees us as, and that it's all about love. It's all about love. Good old Nicodemus, I'm going to call him through most of this time. We're going to call him Nick because I want us to really think that we know him, all right? Nicodemus is so formal as such, so he's going to be Nick to us all, good old Nick. And I don't know about you, but I have always thought, boy, for such a clever guy, he just didn't get it. He just didn't get the simplicity of what Jesus was saying. If there was ever a character in the Bible who you'd like to say, oh, bless your heart, it's Nicodemus. I would chuckle to myself at his expense when I hear him asking Jesus, how can someone be born when they're old? They can't go back into the mother's womb to be born. It's one of those when you read it, or if you were there at the time, you'd have said, did you really say that? I mean, what's going on in your head, Nicodemus? It made him seem like a fool, but a fool he was not. He was a smart cookie. Don't know whether you say that here, but we said back home, you're a smart cookie. He had everything up there. He had all this knowledge. But he just couldn't get his head around this new concept that Jesus was talking about, him being born again. So let's pause for a moment, all right? And let's cut Nick some slack here. Because I think if we are really honest, there's a little bit of him in every one of us. Each of us have questions that we'd rather ask Jesus under the cover of darkness when no one's around instead of asking them when everybody's sitting looking at us. We like to do things privately, don't we? I think Nicodemus was the same. He didn't want to be seen to be associating with Jesus. Each of us have thoughts that we'd rather not share in public. Each of us has a bit of the Nick at night within us, wishing to meet Jesus in secret. He comes to Jesus at night because he felt this was a completely private matter and he wanted to keep it that way. How different it is today. I was just thinking, you know, here was Nick thinking, I don't want others to see or know what's going on in my life. I just want to talk to Jesus one-to-one. And I was just thinking, how different it is today when so many people live their life out on social media. Have you ever noticed that? There are some people who will tell you their whole life story. All the good bits, all the bad bits, and they're pouring it all out for everybody to hear. And of course, they're getting comments back that aren't too positive. And yeah. And you think, why? Why are you doing that? Nicodemus had no intention of making his thoughts public. He just wanted to hear what Jesus had to say. If you've ever read Tolkien's The Hobbit, Riddles in the Darkness, you'll have found that Bilbo Baggins encountered this creature called Gollum. I haven't read the book. I've watched the movie, as I always tell you. But deep in the caves below Goblin City, Bilbo was completely lost, and his only chance of escaping was by winning this contest of riddles with Gollum. And then if he won, he would show him the way out. The drama and the darkness and the riddles all remind me of this chapter of John's Gospel. Because at the heart of this passage today, it seems to be a game of riddles that Jesus is playing with Nicodemus. Nicodemus was no fool, as I said earlier, when it came to theological knowledge. He was a religious leader and a Pharisee. We know that he was a member of the Sanhedrin, the board of directors for Jewish theologians. This was a clever guy. This was a guy, as we heard on the video, who kept all the laws. He knew them all off by heart. He knew that there were 613. And so Nicodemus could not get his head around that no longer Jesus was saying, do these laws really, really matter, because they won't get you into heaven. So we can assume that Nicodemus was well-versed in Scripture, no stranger to theological conversations such as the one that's going on in today's passage. But for some reason, he's struggling with this conversation with Jesus. What really stumped Nick was Jesus inviting him into this metaphorical and spiritual concept when he wanted to stick in the literal. What I can see, what he could see in the world. This whole spiritual realm that Jesus was talking about just did not equate to him. And Jesus tells him, in order to see the kingdom, you must be born from above. That's what the translation really from the Greek and the Hebrew is, that you're born from above. We have changed it to you're born again. When Jesus is talking about seeing the kingdom, he's not referring to having some secret knowledge or a magic word or a magic wand to assure that you were going to go to heaven when you die. Seeing the kingdom is about recognizing what God is doing in this world and then participating in the work with every fiber of our being. And to do that, to be able to do that, Jesus says, you must be born from above. You need to be changed. You need to be born from above. Nick's head is all over the place. You can just imagine his face. He's like a deer in headlights. What's going on? This is impossible. No one can enter his mother's womb, as was said. What is Jesus on? What's rolling about in his brain? Why is he telling me these things when the law says we must do this and we must do this and we must do this? And that'll make us holy. And it might make us holy, but it doesn't make us right with God. That's what Jesus is saying. And so often in church and in all religions, we think that if we follow the rules, there's so many people who believe if they follow the rules, everything's going to be okay. And Jesus is saying everything has changed. Everything has changed. Look, Nicodemus had snuck out of his house under the cover of darkness to have this chat with Jesus, to try and get answers to all the questions that he had. And although he didn't realize it, we would say today that he was under conviction. God was stirring his heart. And I think Nicodemus really wanted to believe, or he wouldn't have even bothered going to talk to Jesus. He wanted to believe what Jesus was saying. The problem for him, it's the same problem you and I have today. The answers that he was going to receive were not the answers he wanted or was expecting. We can all be like him, because if we're honest, we like to have concrete, simple answers, don't we? We like things to be solved and told how to fix things. And often the church is the place to hear such answers, like God is love. Therefore, racism has to be wrong. Killing is evil. And violence is not the way to the kingdom of God. But over my many years as a Christian, I've come to realize that faith is more than simple answers. In fact, faith is more about asking the right questions than getting the right answers. Because I have found that, you know, I have wanted the right answer, and God usually tells me, that's not the answer I'm going to give you. That's the answer that you want. That's not the answer that I want for your life. Out there in the big wide world, we see things happening. And there's no shortage of people who are claiming that they have all the answers. Go into a bookstore, go into Barnes & Noble, and go and see the self-help books and the people. There are thousands of books to tell us we have the answer. We know the answer. Claiming they have the answer to everything, answer to healthcare, answer to the economy, answer to how to lead and heal the painful divide in our nation, how to end conflict in many parts of the world. There's so many experts who think they know the answer. It was just the exact same back in Jesus' day. The Pharisees, the Sanhedrin, they all believed that they had the answer. And some people expect to come to church and receive the answers to life's deepest questions. And yes, that can happen. But today's passage reminds us that Jesus doesn't always answer questions directly or simply. Jesus pushes us deeper than that and encourages us to ask the right questions, the questions that really impact our lives. It's very important to have a safe space to ask deep questions, even if the answers don't appear the right way or in the form that we expected them to. It's important to have that place. I hope that Nicodemus walked away from that conversation with Jesus knowing that he was given the permission to wonder what's this all about, to ask those questions. Jesus gives us permission to ask him these things. It's not wrong to say to him, Jesus, what's going on in my life? I don't know how many times I've asked him that over the years. What's going on? What are you saying? What are you doing? I hope that Nicodemus understood that part of being engaged in deep conversations means it's okay to walk away without all the answers. I find that really hard. I like to know the answer. But Jesus always seems to keep me hanging on there. I always say, through my life, when I've been looking for the answers to things, he has kept me hanging on as if I'm on a cliff edge. You know that way? You're holding on by your fingertips. You ever feel that way? And you think, I'm never going to be able to hold this any longer. Come on, tell me the right answer. Tell me what it is. He never lets us fall, but I always find he makes me wait till the last minute. And I'm not a patient person in certain things. I hope that Nicodemus appreciated that an important part of being in this conversation with God was to surrender to the will of God in his life. That's the big part of this story. Jesus was showing Nick that things had changed. The laws that he knew would no longer save his soul or anyone else, and just attending church today will not save our souls, as good as it is and important as it is. Only by being born from above, born again, saved, whatever term you want to put on it, is the only way to find eternal life. All of us can take the book of order home with us. If you can't sleep at night, it's a good read. It's the laws. It's the do's and the don'ts. It's the same in any religion. We all have structures and we all have ways that we think is so, so important. When Jesus is saying here, the only thing that's really important is for you to love me and to accept that I love you. And this is where Nicodemus was getting totally confused. But what about the laws? And Jesus wasn't saying to throw them all away. He never said that to him. He didn't say, go and burn the laws. Forget about them. But he was telling that things had changed, that the important thing in life was to be born from above, to accept this new life found in Jesus Christ. This was the only way to heaven. Let us understand that being born again, being born from above, is us going from being lost to being found. When people are lost, they're disconnected from God. They lose their direction. They lose God's protection. They don't see their full potential. Their happiness and their future home in heaven is nowhere to be seen if they're just trying to do it by the law. You must be born again. There's one thing in all of this that we will never lose, and that's our value to God, to Jesus. God loved us enough to send his very best to save us and redeem us, Jesus. The most famous verse in the Bible says, for God so loved the world. He loved the world so much that he gave his only son so that anyone who believes in him will not perish but have eternal life. We see it at football games. We see it at different events. People with placards or having it written on their faces, John 3:16. To many in the world today, John 3:16 probably means nothing. But if they Google it, they'll find what it means. Jesus is saying in plain and simple English, I love you. Accept the gift of my son who paid the price for our sins. You matter so much to God that he underwent this rescue mission to come to get you. I think that's amazing. God set up a rescue mission for each one of us. If you were the only one here on earth, God would have came to save you. That's how special you are. He came to earth as a little baby so that one day he would die on a cross for your sin and for mine. Jesus came to earth because you and I needed him. There was no other way. Nicodemus struggled to get his head around that. God sent his son to do something that you and I could never do on our own, and that's pay for our sins. If we didn't need it, God wouldn't have done it. Simple as that. Our sins have made a relationship with God possible. It's impossible on our own. It's only possible through Jesus Christ. That's why he came to earth, to save you from everything you've done wrong, so that you could be forgiven and restored into a right relationship with God. That's what Jesus is trying to get through to Nicodemus as they talk together in the dead of night. I've asked myself many times, why would God give up his divine privileges, his glory and honor, to rescue me? Because I know who I am. We all know who we are as individuals. Why would God do that? Why would God send his son to rescue me? And I get the same answer every time. It's because he loves me. It's because he loves you more than we will ever understand or be able to comprehend. And trying to understand God's love is a bit like going to a tiny toddler and giving him this complex scientific formula and saying, solve that. It's impossible because they don't have the capacity to do that. And it's the same for us, even for Nicodemus, who was so clever. When it came to fully grasping God's love, our minds cannot comprehend it. Our minds are not fully and big enough to get it. But the great thing is, we don't have to understand God's love. We just have to accept it and believe that we are valued by the God of the universe who gave his very best for you. All of us need to be born from above. There's no escaping that. There's no making it easier or giving you a different route to get to heaven. It's believing in Jesus Christ. It's believing in the Son of God. And we either say yes to Jesus, or maybe we do like Nick did in this story. He sort of scratched his head and thought, I'm not sure. I don't know what to do. Yeah, I'm just baffled. But God wants us to put our trust in Jesus, to grab hold of that fact that this is how much God loved us, that he gave his only son, his one and only son. And this is why we won't be destroyed. But by believing in him, anyone can have a true and everlasting life with him. That's it in a nutshell. Trust him. Get right with God. Be born from above. Let's pray. Lord, this morning, you know, maybe we're all a bit like Nicodemus, and we're thinking, what does this actually mean for me? Jesus, I come to church regularly. I'm here nearly all the time. I'm a good person. So what's this born from above? What does this mean to me? Maybe we're struggling to get our heads around that. And Jesus is saying, just let go of things and trust me. Just let go of things and experience my love for you. Just believe. Just believe in the name of Jesus. And know that he came to die for each one of us. In our biggest mess, in our worst situation, he still loves us. And he says, let me change you. Let me make a difference in your life. And Lord, today we ask you to come and change us. We ask that if we have never said it before, we ask that we can be born from above, that we can experience eternal life with you. Thank you for dying for us. Thank you for paying that ultimate price. And thank you that love nailed you to the cross. Thank you that love raised you from the dead. And thank you that your love will go with us into heaven for all eternity. We ask everything in the precious and powerful name of Jesus. Amen. Let's stand as we sing our final song. This is called What a Beautiful Name.
You're here in glory.
Lord bless us as we leave today, and may you have a really lovely Memorial weekend, and enjoy, for those that are getting a day off on Monday, a nice time. But let the Lord bless you, and may we remember that he died so that we could be saved. Have a great week.
Come brokenhearted, let rescue begin. Come find your mercy, oh sinner, come kneel. Earth has no sorrow that heaven can't heal. So lay down.